Hello, I'm Sidney Lumet, and I directed this picture when it was originally done in 64. I'll be watching it now after not having seen it for a very long time. If you're mystified by the title that comes up, New York, 5:30 a.m., and we're into a bullfight, it'll all become clear by the end of the picture. The bullfight footage that we used at the beginning of the movie was stock footage. I don't remember where we got it from, but this was typical of the kind of stuff that you could get from a rental house. And we obviously then took Dan onto a very confined set, as you see, and did his reactions to it. Failsafe was a very successful novel and had been out for some time. When we set out to do the picture, we approached it with tremendous enthusiasm because politically it was about something that we wanted to talk about. One of the interesting things about it was that after years of government assurances that there could be no such thing as an atomic accident, obviously that was something that none of us believed, and both the book and we hope the picture would be something that would open all of that to discussion and questioning. The actor you're looking at is Dan O'Hurley, a wonderful Irish actor. I didn't know him well. This is the only time we ever did a picture together. As you can see, terrific-looking guy, delicate, and yet completely manly. And as you'll see in just a moment, taking on a rather unique role here in the sense that he is a general on the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And his attitude, as you'll see, is very unmilitary, hardly a reactionary, hardly a right-wing, hardly any of the clichés that are usually associated with the military. In fact, quite the opposite.
No time. The meeting starts at 10. Don't worry about it. They always have coffee there.
They both fly down.
I'll check out one of the trainers. That way I can get back when I want. Today.
Shopping. I get clothes for the boys. It goes so fast.
The picture was produced by a wonderful man by the name of Max Youngstein. Max had been in charge of both marketing and basically part of the triumvirate that created and ran United Artists, which in the 40s and 50s and even into the 60s, was one of the most effective studios going. They were a wonderful studio because they weren't a studio. All they did was finance and distribute. They didn't have a physical plant the way Metro did or any of the Hollywood studios. They worked out of New York. The head was a marvelous guy named Arthur Krim. And Max was directly under him. Max left UA because he wanted to be out on his own, creating his own movies. He was a gentle, kind man. I never quite understood what he was doing in movies, really. And completely loving and caring. He didn't want to do junk. He didn't want to do the usual Hollywood movie. He wanted to do something that he felt would make a contribution.
Maybe I have to choose.
The actress working with Dan there is Hildy Parks, a lovely actress. One of the things we'll keep running across is that a lot of the cast a lot of the cast are people who I worked with in what were called the great days of live television. Hildy was certainly one of them.
Could do with a day off.
In the middle of the week? That's immoral. We can go out for dinner. I'll be back by then.
If I can get a sitter.
You got me, you can get anything.
There's an attractive lady, by George. Not a line of dialogue you would normally hear from a general of the United States Army.
Not at all.
The script was done by Walter Bernstein, an old friend of mine. We had also worked together in live television. Walter did the adaptation. He followed the book quite closely. And Walter had been blacklisted for many years. If I remember correctly, was in terms of screenplays, he'd been blacklisted in 1958, 57. This was Walter's first or second, probably, screenplay since he had been blacklisted. He'd been blacklisted in television for a much longer period, from the early 50s. But he, a really promising career had been cut off because the stuff that he had to do under the table was stuff just to make a living with. And it was a terrible loss of years for him. There's Walter Matthau, who you see now as a grumpy old man, one of the great comic actors. But what very few people know about him is that he was just a brilliant actor. He was a marvelous actor. He was a marvelous actor in drama as well. And we had worked together a lot in television, in the theater, and I was thrilled to be able to provide him with a part where the dramatic side of him could emerge.
You call that a culture?
Yes, I do, Mr. Foster. I am not a poet. I am a political scientist who would rather have an American culture survive than a Russian one.
Walter is playing a character called Gottschalk, who is based really on Herman Kahn. This was a very peculiar time in America. There were tremendous conflicts going on, and had been going on not only after the atom bomb, but about the creation of a hydrogen bomb. And as well as scientists being on very different sides, there were also a great many lay people, political scientists, who argued about the consequences of a nuclear war. There were those, of course, who believed that nothing would survive that. I was one of those. And there were people like Herman Kahn who wrote long and complicated articles about the fact that an atomic war was winnable, that not much would survive, but what would survive should be us. They went on to a kind of it got almost absurd in the sense that even Kahn entitled one of the chapters of his books, 60 Million Dead, Will the Living Envy the Dead? I mean, on that kind of sophistry, these arguments would go on, and they were theoretically very respectable opinions. And Walter's character is based on Herman Kahn, who was the foremost speaker, foremost mouthpiece for that point of view.
I'd like you to take me home.
The actress is Nancy Berg, a very successful model at the time. A great many of us involved in the picture got involved because we did care about the way things were going politically. That would include Walter, that would include Fonda, that would include Bernstein, myself, Max, who produced it.
You could joke about the convicts and file clerks because you know there won't be any survivors, will there?
Not many.
None. None at all. That's the beauty of it.
I've heard nuclear war called a lot of things, Miss Wolfe. Never beautiful.
People are afraid to call it that, but that's what they feel.
The beauty of death?
Don't patronize me. What else but that are you selling, Professor? And we all know we're going to die. But you make a game out of it, a marvelous game that includes the whole world. You make it seem possible.
It is possible, even probable.
These kinds of arguments that you're hearing in this particular scene actually went on at the time. That's one of the never-ending mysteries to me, that that kind of foolishness could be taken seriously. So they were expressing very genuine points of view.
Turn in there.
This where you live?
Don't joke.
Why not?
The picture had a very strange beginning. The book, as I said before, had been a tremendous bestseller. And unbeknownst to us, working on the picture, about 4 or 5 weeks before we were to begin shooting, we were sued. Max Youngstein had raised the money privately. We were not a studio picture. We were a genuine independent. But we were sued by Columbia Pictures and Stanley Kubrick. Stanley was at work on a picture which eventually was called Dr. Strangelove, or How I Stopped Worrying and Learned to Love the Bomb. His picture was based on a book called Red Alert. Ours was this bestseller by Eugene Burdick and Harvey Wheeler. His was a bestseller in England, had not sold much in the United States. Ours was a tremendous bestseller here. I don't know how it sold in England. And Columbia and Stanley sued, along with the author of Red Alert, on the basis of plagiarism. I had never read Red Alert. I had no idea whether it was sensible story of whether it was a duplicate of ours. I knew nothing about it. But I did know that we were in serious trouble. The plagiarism suit never got to court. It got settled out of court. And where it got settled, the way it got settled, was that Columbia Pictures, which was putting up the money and going to distribute Stanley's picture, bought up our picture and was now going to be distributing both. The result, of course, was that they had complete control over the picture that could have been a conceivable problem for them in the distribution of Dr. Strangelove.
Why do you think I'm calling? Well, where did you get the money?
The actor there is Fritz Weaver, again, a friend of ours from television, and I'd also worked with him in the theater. Everything you're going to see in terms of the military end of it, the SAC headquarters here in Omaha, is all done without any idea of authenticity because we could get absolutely no cooperation from the Defense Department.
General Fogan's office, Ammon
Slope. This included plenty of pictures that we were not to be given, would include stock footage, which we were not to be given, no matter what we asked for, it was denied us. One of the interesting things was that Henry Fonda, on a visit to Nebraska, which is where he was born, was guided around SAC headquarters and shown everything very freely. But, as I say, literally, not only wouldn't they let us take a look at it just so we could duplicate it, they wouldn't even give us a picture. The budget on the picture was extremely low. Everything, here we are supposed to be in Nebraska, I found myself as close as possible to a what I thought might pass for a small urban area in Nebraska, and it's on 54th Street, right across the street from the studio.
Yeah?
I'm General Bogan. I'm looking for Colonel Cassio. He gave this address.
Oh, sure now, General.
That's a gentleman.
Honored to have you. Son always speaks well of you.
Sorry to bother you, Colonel. We have some unexpected VIPs we have to show around.
The general in this scene is Frank Overton. Again, somebody I'd worked with extensively in television. In television, a lovely actor who then went on, actually, from this picture to a very successful career in Hollywood.
I just take a drop now and then. The boy, he gets a little excited.
I'm ready, sir.
Damn snot nose.
Now that I've told you, you see it does look like 54th Street, doesn't it?
It's that Congressman Raskob, the one who's been nosing around the bases. Washington wants us to put his mind at ease. He's on one of those committees.
Yes, sir.
Gordon Knapp will also be there to look over some of that equipment his company makes. He'll be on our side. Anyone looks cross-eyed at his stuff, he goes up like a rocket.
Yes, sir.
As the picture goes on, you'll notice a very interesting lighting pattern. Gerald Hirschfeld, who was the cinematographer, had a very successful career in commercials. In fact, owned his own commercial house and was desperate to get it back into feature work. He had done, I think, a feature before. Slowly, as the picture progresses, he used stronger and stronger top light. It worked wonderfully for the picture, first of all because it was the way the light in the place was motivated, and from there on just brought us a greater and greater sense of drama as the picture went on. The pool player on the right, there he is, who just shot, is a wonderful actor by the name of Eddie Binns. I don't know how many pictures we did together. He was in 12 Angry Men. He was in The Verdict. We worked together an awful lot. He was one of my favorite actors. He's expressing, really, the basic theme of the piece. The first time somebody makes some sort of remark to the effect that he wishes a little for the old days where he could fly without the plane flying him, where he was able to actually fly the plane.
You know something, Billy? I like the personal fact.
Now, here's one of the interesting things. Here's the shot of the plane taking off. We could not get any stock footage at all. They not only any Department of Defense footage, but eventually, but very rapidly, all of the footage that the stock houses had was cut off from us. You could get almost any footage you wanted in rental houses. We could not get any. And the shot that you just saw of five planes taking off is actually the only shot we were able to bootleg, treated in five different ways optically. So we just had to make do with one shot that we were given. The main room here, which at what is supposed to be SAC headquarters, is obviously, as I said before, created out of our own imaginations. It doesn't look anything like this, really. Al Brenner, who was the art director, did a marvelous job because we had very, very little money to do the film. And you're looking at, in looking at the big screen, we're looking at footage that was created by a remarkable couple, John and Faith Hubley, who ran a place called Storyboard. John was an ex-employee of Disney, was thrown out of Disney when he led one of the strikes against it, and of the animators, and subsequently joined a new company called UPA, which really changed cartooning in movies. They were the creators of Gerald McBoing-Boing and Mr. Magoo. And John and Faith did this footage for us, literally, in animation. And they did it almost all themselves. I think maybe had one or two other people working for them. And as you see, it plays an integral part in the movie.
We have instruments so good, Mr. Raskob, they can tell the difference between a whale breaking wind and that sub blowing its tanks.
No argument, General. I'm sure we've got the best of money in mind.
We're very proud of what we do here, sir.
You ought to be, Colonel.
Money's well spent, Mr. Raskob.
I don't doubt it for a minute. And you don't have to snow me, General. My committee doesn't deal with...
You can see the set was enormously complex, but had to be done at such minimum, for such minimum cost, that, what looks like stucco wasn't stucco, needless to say. It was, simply painted, well painted. The computers that you see lining the upper balconies were literally blocks of wood with some sort of foiled paper over them. The spinning discs, supposedly holding the tapes, were literally on a simple pulley behind the set, pulling all of them. They could only go a certain amount of time in one direction, then had to be reversed because we didn't have the ability to keep them going past a certain length of time.
If you want to know, that's what really bothers me.
Now you're seeing the light pattern beginning to emerge here on Sorrel Book, a wonderful actor. Mostly Broadway, but we had done some television work together.
What you're seeing, gentlemen, is an unidentified flying object picked up by our radar. Until we get positive identification, we regard it as hostile.
What do you do about it?
Well, we've gone to condition blue, which is our lowest form of readiness. At the same time, we've informed those Vindicator bombers that you saw on the air before. They will now start to fly toward their failsafe points.
Failsafe?
Fixed points in the sky on the perimeter of the Soviet Union, which are changed from day to day. The planes will fly to those points and orbit until they get a positive order to go in.
And if they don't...
Brenner did a superb job on the set, really. I don't know how he did it for the budget money we had.
Except on an express order.
How do they get that order? By radio?
Yes, and through a box we call the failsafe box aboard each plane, which can only be activated at the express order of the president.
Oh, he has to tell them.
Not directly, no. His voice can be imitated, you know. He just gives the order, and the rest is done electronically. No one can interfere with the failsafe box, Mr. Raskob. No one.
We were shooting the picture in at the Fox Studios on 54th Street. 54th Street and 10th Avenue. They had one large stage. This set took up the entire large stage. And the smaller stage they had, we built our other sets on.
And if it isn't?
in it, something else. Well, that means it's at 30,000.
I was making the film in New York only because I'd always been making movies here and didn't want to go out to the coast. I don't know that the coast would have been good for us anyway. I don't know whether we would have been able to do it for this cost in California.
Oh, normal procedure, Mr. Raskob. We start an automatic countdown at this point.
One of the things I loved about what John and Faith did was the sense of transmission lines that you get on the screen. They also had a terrific problem in making sure that the contrast was printed in such a way that we could read the streamers below, because later on they will contain a lot of the information that we need very badly from a plot point of view.
6 minutes to failsafe.
All of this was being projected by rear projection. We were doing the main room. We didn't have the space in the studio for rear projection. This set had rear projection, but in the big room, it was on front projection. We had to be extremely careful, and people were being driven crazy because you could not allow anybody to smoke. And we couldn't allow any dust in the air either, because you would pick up the projection beams, and it obviously had to look as if it was happening on the screen, much like a television screen, not anything that could be projected.
Good morning, Mr. Secretary. Good morning, Mr. Secretary.
There, the actor with the crutches is a wonderful actor by the name of William Hansen. He and I go back a long way together. I was a kid actor, and Bill played with me in a play, the first play that William Saroyan had on Broadway, called My Heart's in the Highlands. I was 13 at the time. So it's an old, old relationship. Again, here, I have no idea whether the whether a war room at the Pentagon would look like this, but not bad, considering we had no money and no reference points.
It is not theoretical. On it depends the kind of weapons we use, where we locate them, how we use them. In short, our entire...
I like Jerry's lighting pattern very, very much. It's got a sense of real drama about it, and that will intensify as the movie goes on. The light boxes that you see on top there were obviously meant to be the sources of TV projection on the screens that you see.
In the last war, both sides could have used bacterial warfare. They didn't.
It wouldn't have been decisive.
Can you be sure?
Well, maybe people still couldn't get used to the idea of killing civilians.
I suggest you take that up with the civilians of London, Hamburg.
I had done, I think, 7 black and white pictures and 1 color picture with Boris Kaufman, one of the great, great cameramen. I think chances are he was not available for this. I'm sure I would have asked him first. And for some reason, maybe he was working another picture. He was getting quite old by then. He might have been ill. But I went to Jerry because he was so eager for the job. His ideas seemed so solid, and I knew that from a technical point of view, he was absolutely superb. I mean, when you look down that row, that the depth of focus there is not an easy thing to achieve, especially when you don't have the money for an awful lot of lighting equipment.
You carry out policy. You don't make it.
Don't kid yourself, Stark. The way we say a war can be fought is making policy. If we say we can fight a limited war with nuclear...
Here you can see Dan O'Hurley, his character, starting to talk in terms of politics in a way that I don't think very many generals would actually talk.
No,
definitely a minority opinion.
Not with hydrogen bombs, there isn't. Once those bombs start to drop, you won't be able to limit a damn thing.
Are you advocating disarmament, General Blake?
I don't know.
It's the logic of your position. Peculiar reversal. Press would be interested. The military man who is the dove and the civilian who is the hawk.
We're going too fast. Things are getting out of hand.
Can you be more specific, General?
We're all trying to make war more efficient.
That's our job.
And we're succeeding. We now have the capacity to blow up the whole world several times over.
Which does not mean we must do it.
We won't be able to stop from doing it. That's the logic of your position, Grota Schiller. We're setting up a war machine that...
I don't know how intensely people were discussing this kind of thing. I know clearly the government was, because, as we know from not being able to get... from their resistance to us making this picture. But... and I know I would talk about these kinds of things, Walter would. But I don't know across America how thoroughly any of this was being discussed. I wish I could feel that it was being talked about constantly. I don't really know.
But our intention is always to minimize those risks. Of course, we can only control our own actions. Our concept of limited war is based on an equal rationality on the part of the Russians. It also presupposes there will be no accidents on either side. But suppose, for an example, that unidentified flying object was one of their 50 megaton missiles that had gotten loose by mistake. What could be done? How could they prove it was really an accident? Would it make any difference if they could? Even if we believed them, should we still think in terms of limiting our response, or should we hit them back with everything we have?
It's gone, Jim. What happened to it?
Colonel Cassio?
Sir.
Let's go to condition yellow. It's dropped below the level at which our radar can pick it up, that's all.
You went to the next state of readiness.
Well, that's SOP, Mr. Knapp. Could be a commercial plane about.
One of the interesting things is that the footage that is supplying this picture and the footage that was supplying the picture at the in the war room were actually physically the same print. We did not have the money. To literally make, we had to watch the dollar so carefully that we wouldn't even make two prints of this.
Green.
And then?
Red. But we've never gone to red yet.
Red means war. What does that mean?
Well, jet planes suck air through their engines. Our warning system can pick up the turbulence this creates.
Could be a commercial plane that's lost power. No turbulence would be created.
You're right.
Yes. Off course.
Heavy arm.
1 minute to failsafe.
The Russian rockets are coming in low. Our radar can't pick it up.
Could it be that?
Could be anything.
How do you find out?
Countdown will now be
in second. Fighters are tracking it.
15,
can't wait too long.
14. 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8.
The symbols 7, used of the 6, little triangular
3, 2, 1,
icon for the bombers is, of course, a pre-advanced copy. We knew nothing about the stealth bomber at the time. But it's funny that even today, it is still used in sort of the dopier sci-fi movies.
I'll have to ask you gentlemen to leave now.
Sorry.
That is an order, Mr. Raskob.
You've got the wrong customer, General. The way I see it, we could be at war in just about 2 minutes. They can't get me back to my family in that time, so I'm staying right here and see what happens.
There's no place for you here.
Those bombs go off, General. There's no place for me anywhere. If you want me out of here, you better call those MPs.
I think it's coming up again.
We can't wait any longer, sir.
Give me tight scale.
I never saw this picture playing with an audience. I don't know if it had a tremendous amount of tension to it or not, but I know that the it's undergoing a peculiar kind of revival now. But I've been asked about it in Europe recently, and and there have been people wanting to interview me about it here in the United States. It's interesting that It's going through a kind of revival of interest. This, believe it or not, was not a set. There was out near LaGuardia Field a small flight trainer that was being used for training commercial pilots. And we were able to rent it. It had broken down. They were repairing it. But we were able to rent it for the period while they were repairing it because we didn't need any of the flight simulation things to be working. We just needed the sense of metal. We needed the electronic bulbs to light up. And we rented it for 3 days and shot everything that took supposedly taking place in the plane in there.
K-13. Something blew in the fault indicator, sir. We're replacing the whole unit.
The fault indicator is our master control. Tells us if something goes wrong in any of these other components.
Does something go wrong?
No sign of it. We'll know as soon as they replace the unit.
There, believe it or not, is Dom DeLuise. Dramatic actor, as you'll see in a subsequent scene coming up. He was an ex-student of mine at Performing Arts, which is where I knew him from originally, and I always loved his dramatic work when he was a kid, and just studying acting at the High School of Performing Arts. But he went on, as you know, to becoming just a kind of wild foil in all the Burt Reynolds movies.
Interference. You mean you can't get through? What kind of interference?
I don't know, sir. It's a kind I never heard before.
Well, try another band. Try all of them.
Can't get through, Colonel.
You must be trying to keep us from getting our go signal.
Well, they're too late for that.
Request permission to authenticate on secondary channel.
All of this was done live. We didn't shoot silently. I just felt for performance. The biggest problem in performance was how to keep the tension level rising. And that meant the tension level for the actors. So as little fakery as possible under what was obviously a...
Request permission to verify, sir.
A very fanciful situation was very hard to maintain. And any way we could reinforce that for them, we did. I have no idea how close any of this goes to the any of this was to the actual procedures that were the Air Force would be following. We couldn't, as I said, we couldn't get any technical help. However, I assume that Burdick and Wheeler knew something about it. We were getting this directly from the book, from the novel. I've always pitied actors who had to play Air Force people because the oxygen mask covers half the face. But it's enormously effective.
Ready for approach and penetration order, sir.
So you say these alerts happen half a dozen times a month.
How about that? Not usually so dramatic. We rarely get to the fail-safe point.
Well, I'd be a nervous wreck.
Well, so would I if I had to make a speech in Congress.
Oh, yeah?
General Bogan, that blip up there at 10 o'clock is headed into Russia.
And that is why some people advocate a return to manned bombers for a first-strike retaliation rather than missiles. They are slower and therefore give more time for evaluation and analysis. The rockets have the defects of their virtues. They are too quick. They allow too little time for thought. Now, I find this point of view old-fashioned by the very nature of modern warfare.
Put that on polar projection.
What a wonderful job Faith and John did on this, the Hubleys, because it's not easy to conceive these kinds of things. The verbal descriptions are one thing. And here comes the man that we all wish was President of the United States. Anytime. Not this guy. This guy you may remember from Dallas. That's Larry Hagman, a superb young actor at the time.
Hello, Buck. How's your Russian today?
Fine, sir. I guess.
Good. We may need it.
I think there's a reason that Fonda played the president, I think, four or five times in his lifetime, as well as playing Abe Lincoln. Even the back of his head looks like a president.
Well, Joe, nothing makes to the newspapers. Nothing. Not yet, anyway. Call the vice president and tell him what's up.
We had worked together many times. He was in 12 Angry Men. And then my first picture. Then he was in the second picture that I did. Not the second, the third. A picture with Susan Strasberg. So this was our third... Yeah, our third picture together.
Secretary of Defense, Chiefs of Staff.
One of the joys of working in New York is the level of acting you get in all of the small parts. That actress, that's Frieda Altman, who was a big favorite on Broadway, character actress, doing literally a two-line part for us.
What's happened, Buck?
No, sir.
One of our Vindicator groups got a wrong signal, took off to Mount Moscow. We've got to stop it.
Here comes one of the most interesting props I've ever seen. I was looking for something. I told Al Brenner, I need something that really looks important. I need the most important-looking telephone in the world that nobody knows about so that we can have something totally impressive. And it's about to come up. And then I'll tell you what it actually is in reality.
You know what went wrong?
No, sir, we do not.
Why can't you raise them by radio?
We don't know for sure, sir. We've tried all frequencies. We just can't make contact.
Why?
I don't know.
Fonda would always be my first choice for anything. He is, to me, James Mason, and Spencer Tracy were, for me, the best actors, the best male actors in movies.
It's possible the fail-safe mechanism might be giving them a go signal at the same time they can't reach you for positive confirmation.
It's possible. It's not probable, but...
Is it possible?
Yes, sir.
All right, now, if we do regain radio contact, will the bombers respond to an order to return?
If we can reach them within the next 5 minutes, after that, their orders ought to disregard any verbal command.
If I talk to them, even from me?
Your voice can be imitated by the enemy, sir. Our men have been drilled in that. Once they're beyond a certain point, they're not to trust any verbal transmission.
What's our next step, then, General, if we follow standard procedure?
We already have fighter planes in the air. The next step would be to order the fighters after the bombers to raise them visually and divert them from their course.
But if the bombers don't respond, then what?
The fighters would be ordered to shoot them down.
Who gives that order?
You do, sir.
Thank you, General. I'll be back to you. Get me Mr. Swenson in the Pentagon.
One of the interesting things that Brenner did was that the grayness, the use of gray, black, and white in very severe tones, really gathers a kind of cumulative tension about it just by itself.
The president says he may have to order our fighters to shoot down Group 6. He wants our opinion.
I oppose it, sir, on the grounds that it's premature. Our planes have not...
There were never any discussions about shooting it in color. From the beginning, we felt that it would be a big mistake to do it in color, that we could never create exactly what you're looking at.
When they got the all clear, they've been flying in opposite directions.
But they're faster than the Vindicators.
Not that much faster. I'm not sure they can catch up in time.
They can go to afterburners. That'll increase their speed.
And use up their fuel? We'll never be able to get back. We'll go down in the ocean.
We've got to try it.
Suppose they do catch up. Why do they have to attack? Can't they signal? Our men have been trained to expect anything from the enemy, even sending up his own fighter planes disguised as ours.
They're good men. We've seen to that. If their orders are attacked, the only way you're going to stop them is to shoot them down.
We've got no alternative. This minute, the Russians are watching their boards, trying to figure out what we're up to. If we can't convince them it's an accident, which we're trying to correct by any means, we're going to have something in our hands that nobody bargained for. And only a lunatic wants.
Mr. President, it is our opinion that the fighters should be ordered in. Thank you. General Bogan, please.
Yes, Mr. President.
One of the things about the lighting is it's very old-fashioned, too, which I loved. Some of the large close-ups remind me of stills that I've seen from some of the Eisenstein movies.
Colonel, order the fighters to attack Group 6.
Always an interesting factor in the movie. Ralph Rosenblum is the editor here, and sometimes you can create enormous tension by just staying on a shot and staying on a shot and staying on a shot. Other times you can create the tension by cutting and at an increasingly rapid rate. It's very hard to decide in advance which it'll be, and yet you do have to, because if you're going to use the legato technique, the sustained take, there's not much that that you can do about it if you haven't made the shot a continuous shot. If the shot itself has been only 20 seconds, you can't get a 40-second or minute and a half take out of it. So you have to make some of the decision in advance. And yet, the editors very often tend to want to accelerate the cutting tempo in a melodrama. It's not always the best process. In this one, I believe we slowly kept increasing the tempo as we went. But here you see a long, sustained dolly in, no cuts to reactions, just the tension developing out of watching the action so clearly, and action done in actual animation.
2, 1, mark!
Will I alert Air Sea Rescue, sir?
I would, I was very possessive, I've always been very possessive about the actual physical film. I didn't even like the sticks to be cut off the beginning of a take without my being there. It was literally a possessiveness. It wasn't even about control. I had total faith in Ralph. We had worked together before. And yet, I wanted to be there as literally each splice was made. And that's pretty much the way we worked, on this, on The Pawnbroker, on all of the pictures that we did together.
I have, try to get to know how I think. Might come in handy.
Yes, sir.
General Bogan sound to you.
One of the great joys of working here, as opposed to working on the coast, was that you worked with only the people who were working on your picture. If one was working at a studio, there could conceivably, although by this time it had calmed down enormously, but you would have the head of the editing department, and he might have as much to say about your picture as the editor himself. There were echelons. He only spoke to the studio executives. He didn't speak to the director. And the same was true in art departments. Same thing was true in the camera department. There were heads of departments, and they would be participating in the picture without ever having any direct responsibility.
Yes, Mr. President.
If our fighters have to shoot down the Vindicators, the worst is over. For us, anyway. I want your people now to consider what we do if they can't shoot them down. I'm putting you on the intercom so everything you say can be heard here and in Omaha. General Bogan has Mr. Knapp of Amalgamated Electronics and Congressman Raskob with him. They have my permission to listen in, say anything they want.
Right, sir.
Gentlemen, we've got four questions to answer, not a hell of a lot of time. First, what happened? Second, what do we do about it? Third, what are the rest?
One of the joys of Max Youngstein as a financier and as a producer was that, having gotten the money, he would then join us at Rush's sometime. Other than that, I didn't see him until the rough cut.
A double mechanical failure? Do you know the odds against that, sir?
Maybe someone went berserk.
It doesn't matter. Something failed. A man, a machine. It was bound to happen that did. Maybe we'll never know why or what.
I don't remember the picture changing a great deal from the first cut till the first cut I finished to the last, except for coming down in time. I don't remember how much had to come out, but not a lot, not a heck of a lot, because it was a very tight script to begin with. In fact, as I look at it now, I can see a number of things, quite a few at the beginning, that I would love to take out.
The machines are supervised by humans.
The beginning of the picture had what I call the rubber ducky school about it. It was trying to provide psychological backgrounds for the people, like there, Fritz Weaver standing in the background, Colonel Cassio showing his family and so on, as it would affect his actions later in the picture. I don't think any of that was really necessary. I think he could absolutely do everything he's doing with complete clarity about his motives just within the body of the picture. All of the backgrounds that we put in were all part of the novel. That's true. It was as much a part of novel writing as it was as of screenwriting.
If they wanted to do that, they wouldn't need an excuse. They'd simply attack.
This way, they've made us commit a group of our fighter planes, our first line of defense. Made us kill our own men.
I disagree with Colonel Cassio's analysis. I think we have to assume that it is our accident and not their plan.
I go along with you, General.
Yes, Saunders?
Report on what the Russians have in the air, sir.
This came from a novel, and I did a lot of adaptations of plays. For me, there's never been any particular right way or wrong way about it. Plays can be marvelous, make marvelous movies. Novels can, and clearly short stories can, and clearly original stories can. So I think the only thing that matters is how good is it. I don't think there's any formula to it. Ever.
And when they saw it fly past?
They send up their fighter planes, just in case. I don't think they'll take any action unless their border is crossed.
Agreed. That puts it up to the fighters.
In my opinion, they will take no action at all.
They're not going to just sit there, Professor.
I think if our bombers get through, the Russians will surrender.
Who's this professor, Mr. Secretary? What's he doing there?
Professor Gordashev is a civilian advisor to the Pentagon.
The acceleration in the editing is starting to happen, especially now that we've got both rooms, the war room and SAC headquarters, in communication with each other and with the president.
The war would leave the Soviet Union utterly destroyed. Therefore, they would surrender.
But suppose they feel they can knock us off first?
They know we might have a doomsday system. Missiles that will go into action days, even weeks after a war is over, and destroy an enemy even after that enemy has already destroyed us.
Maybe they think that even capitalists aren't that insane to want to kill after they themselves have been killed.
These are Marxist fanatics, not normal people.
They do not reason the way you reason, General.
I've never liked the shooting of over-the-shoulder, close-up, close-up. It becomes predictable, and it doesn't add anything to the drama. My approach to the camera is really very simple. It starts with, you know, that wonderful question I always get from students when we're talking. How do you know where to put the camera? The answer is extremely simple. You put the camera, as you're reading the script, you say, what do I want to see at this moment? And that's how you decide where you're going to put the camera. The main thing is to keep the camera functioning as what I believe it really is, which is another leading character. If on something like Long Day's Journey Into Night, there are four stars in that movie, I have five stars by virtue of the fact that I'm photographing it. And the camera has as great a function to perform as Ralph Richardson or Katharine Hepburn. And here, camera is an integral part of what we're trying to do. The amount of close-ups, shooting below eye level a great deal of the time. As you see, most of the shots are below eye level. The camera is below eye level of the actors. You use static camera so that you can save movement for when it has something to say, when it has some real need. There is a move at the end of the picture when Fonda is talking with the Soviet premier and Larry Hagman is translating. And there are two counter dollies in there that I think are absolutely marvelous. And they have been set up by all of these static shots.
They've gone down into the sea.
You see the intensity of the light getting more and more so.
The chances of our bombers getting through to Moscow.
As the picture is progressing.
We've made the calculations 100 times. What they have in the way of defense is what our planes are capable of doing. The Vindicators fly so fast, the Russians won't be able to use all their defensive apparatus. One or two of the bombers will get through.
Thank you. Buck, I'm going to talk to the Soviet premier now. You'll translate what he says to me. He'll have his own translator telling what I say.
I'm pretty sure this was Larry Hagman's first movie.
I think the premier will be saying what he means. He usually does, but sometimes there's.
He'd been in the theater. He'd been doing a lot of work in the theater and in live TV.
One language that don't carry the same weight in another. You follow me?
Whenever I see one of those beautiful close-ups of Fonda just thinking and looking so calm and yet responsible, and I keep thinking, well, what do you think? Can George W. make it? And can Big Al Gore, what would they be like under the circumstances? They'd probably take a poll before they did anything.
And don't be afraid. Say what you think. Don't be afraid all this is too big for you, Buck. It's big, all right, but it still depends on what each of us does. History lesson number one. I'll talk to Moscow now.
Here comes the phone. Here comes the phone. Now, you know what that is in actuality. It's a phone that they use on construction sites when they're dynamiting heavily. And I just, when Al brought it in, I thought, that's it. That looks like an important conversation is going to take place on that.
Mr. Chairman, this is the President of the United States. Do you hear me clearly?
Fine, Mr. President. How are you?
Mr. Chairman, I'm calling you on a matter of great urgency.
One of the great problems in the whole picture was to keep not only keep the level of intensity rising for what would be the audience eventually, but also for the actors in the performance. And Fonda and Hagman particularly had that problem because they were spending their time in a phone conversation, and that is a very different kind of drama than looking another actor in the face and seeing what the other actor is projecting toward you in terms of the other actor's feelings, and you can feed on that. You can get something out of that. Obviously, neither of them had that luxury here. So what I thought would be beneficial would be, since Hagman was providing the translation, which is what Fonda would be dealing with anyway, but I wanted to give him some sense of what, as close to the reality as I could. I did have a Russian-speaking actor doing the dialogue that that Hagman was reporting in on the other end of the phone, so that they were constantly hearing Russian being spoken. Notice here again how long we've just sat on this shot. There hasn't been a cut for, I would think, at least two minutes. I haven't looked at the clock, but
responsibility that we're doing everything we can to correct it.
In a room like this, you've got two people and four walls, and so you've got to save your editing tempos. You've got to save movement. You've got to hold back on everything as long as possible, because you've got a long way to go.
How do I know the planes were not simply diving to a low altitude to escape our radar?
On our plotting board, the action could only be interpreted as planes out of control. You have the same equipment we do. What did it tell you?
It did not tell us what is in your mind, Mr. President.
I'm telling you that.
And you ask me to believe you.
You must believe me.
You ask for belief at a curious time.
If we don't trust each other now, Mr. Chairman, there may not be another time.
We saw your plane fall into the sea.
One of the things I love so about Hagman's performance, you know, there are certain kinds of performances where you've got to read a letter or make a speech, or doing what I'm doing now, extemporaneously commenting on something that's going on in front of me. And Larry captures so brilliantly the whole idea of a simultaneous translation. There's no sense of acting. There's no sense of preparation. His syntax is all broken up. It's very difficult to do what he was doing, because it goes against all of the normal impulses that you have when you're acting. And he's doing it wonderfully. And also that he doesn't dramatically emphasize anything. He doesn't play the... there's no sense of performance in him at all.
You know we must protect ourselves.
You also know that if you launch missiles, we must do the same. If that happens, there'll be very little left of the world.
I understand. Is there anything more you wish to say?
If I may make a suggestion, I will arrange to open the conference line between our headquarters in Omaha and your similar officials in the Soviet Union. We will do all we can to help you.
We do not need your help.
We rehearsed 2 weeks, as I do on every picture.
I must tell you what my people tell me.
I think almost all of us who came from live TV rehearsed, and those of us who came from the theater managed to rehearse our movies. And I think Mike Nichols does. I think John Frankenheimer does.
I see what our fighters do.
There was the first cut in the sequence. So I think that sustained shot was probably close to 5 minutes. That whole scene, actually, which quite a sustained scene, and I see by the clock it's probably close to 6 minutes, 7 minutes, actually was done in three setups. The one sustained setup of the two shot, then two individuals for the end of it, when they don't quite dare look at each other, and then the last high shot of the two of them sitting there.
How's the formation holding, Sullivan?
Everyone in line, sir.
How far from the border?
2 minutes.
I think the straight film directors are not used to rehearsing and don't like it particularly. They think it'll kill spontaneity. It doesn't. In fact, the actors usually can be more spontaneous because they really know what they're doing. Therefore, they're relaxed.
Go to work.
Roger.
Project the Soviet fighter planes. Give me type scale on the Russian border.
I've never found any difference in actors on who come from the theater and actors who've come from film. They don't...
Well, Buck, we're into Soviet territory.
Their techniques may vary, but fundamentally they are doing the same thing.
The war now exists.
Give me enemy defense performance.
This is enemy defense performance desk, General Bogan.
How do you read the situation?
Our number six plane carrying defensive equipment and masking devices has moved into the lead. All those new little blips you see are decoys that it's from.
Have the Russian fighters launched any missiles yet?
Not yet. You'll see their missiles on your scope.
Usually, in those days, my own familiarity with the actors was so enormous because coming from television, doing 40 shows a year when I was doing a weekly show, at least a cast of at least minimally 10 actors a show, you rapidly got to know a lot of the talent that was around. And so the casting was generally quite easy.
This isn't some damn football game, remember that.
That plane's in trouble.
One of the joys, by the way, of shooting in New York at that time, and it's still true today, we do not have something like the Screen Extras Guild. Extras, people come in just for the day, non-speaking parts, are actors. They're in off-Broadway plays at night or Broadway plays, and that helps enormously because you're not just sitting there with people who are just picking up a day's check. They are completely involved in the experience. I know that Dog Day Afternoon could never have been the picture it was if I'd had to shoot it out in Hollywood, because a lot of the atmosphere and the truth of that picture was created by the extras in the street, the extras playing the cops, the spectators, the newspaper people, and for that I needed actors.
Said,
what luck are your fighters having?
Spear?
Luck?
Никакого.
No luck at all. We have shot down only one of your bombers.
Well, what about the other five?
Maybe yes, maybe no. Your masking devices are better.
It looks like the same shot as the previous sequence. It is not. The camera's eye level has dropped, probably close to a foot. The lens has been changed also, and as you can see, we are now starting individual shots so that editing starts to play a part, and we are also starting the first of the camera movement down here.
My generals are not so happy with me about this.
All of this is done very gently. Nothing bothers me more than when you, as an audience, see the techniques I'm using to make a scene work. I don't think it's anybody's business what I'm doing, and I don't like it to show. But notice that the two dollies are absolute counterparts to one another. The first one started on tight on Hank and pulled back to a two-shot. This one started tight on Larry, pulled back to a two-shot. So that there was a balance in the two camera movements.
Flash on our plotting board. We think this is connected to some mechanical failure that might have activated their go signal. Could this have been caused by your radio interference?
They're arguing with him again, sir.
matching close-ups. I kept the scenes in here in great balance, in the use of lenses and in the editing pattern.
I do not know about this jamming.
I think he does.
We cannot be responsible for your mechanical failures.
Is it possible? Could it have happened? You asked for proof, Mr. Chairman. This could be it.
Arguing back and forth. Don't trust you. Have to trust you. It's a trick.
We're paying for our mutual suspicions, Mr. Chairman. I realize that, but the wall must be broken. We have to break it down now. We can't afford not to trust each other.
We jammed your radios with a special device. Even I did not know about. I suppose I must be very proud of our scientists. It was more effective than anyone dreamed.
But why? Why this time?
We have computers like yours. They computed that this time your alert might be real.
One of the things that's very interesting in all of this is that all these arguments about who gave secrets to who and spies and so on and so forth, everybody acknowledged, and you see it being dramatized in this scene, that really everybody had pretty much the same equipment all the way up and down the line.
Will he return on your command?
There's a chance.
I'll give that order.
General Bogan.
Yes, Mr. President.
Put me through to Group 6, fast.
Right away, sir.
What's the group commander's name?
Colonel Jack Grady, sir.
Does he have a wife?
I'll see, sir.
31, this is Ultimate One. Can you hear me?
I think the Russians were the constant villain. They had replaced the Japanese.
Yes, sir, he does.
Actually, the movie made them quite human, made the premiere quite human, and then later on there's a conversation between Frank Overton and his Russian counterpart.
I have an important message. Turkey One, can you hear me?
Me. Turkey One, can you hear me? Turkey One, can you hear me? This is Ultimate One. Can you hear me?
They've stopped jamming us.
This is Turkey One. Turkey One, I am not authorized to receive messages.
Colonel Grady, this is the President of the United States. The mission you are flying has been triggered by a mechanical failure. It is a mistake. I order you and the other planes to return to your base at once. Do you hear? At once. Colonel Grady, I repeat, this is the President.
I can no longer receive tactical alterations by voice.
I know that, but...
But you're telling me I've been specifically ordered not to do.
Damn it, Grady, this is the President.
He's still on, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I think it would be wise for you to remove yourself from Moscow so that you'll be out of danger. That will allow us to continue negotiations even if the worst happens.
I have made those arrangements. Unfortunately, we cannot remove Moscow. It remains here, open to your bombs, and when it is destroyed, its people dead because there is no time to evacuate them. Where shall we negotiate, Mr. President? Shall I come to Geneva, hat in hand, begging for peace?
I offered you help, you refused it. I offered again. We will help you shoot down the planes.
Set up your conference line. I'll come back on the phone when I'm a safe distance from Moscow.
Will you activate the Element One Red One touch phone, please?
Can we stop them, sir?
One of the things I always loved about Fonda was his physical grace. There's just nothing he can do that's awkward. Gets up out of a chair, it's a lovely thing to see. Fritz Weaver was primarily a theater actor. We had worked together down at the Phoenix Theater here in New York, as was Sorrel Book. And I think this was Fritz's first movie also.
flew down a quarter ago.
Just this section, it didn't move at all. This section, not anymore at all. It is that plane continued on the course. And it shouldn't be a certain message in the last half hour or so.
Excuse me.
I would think so, yes.
Every minute we wait works against us. Now, Mr. Secretary, now is when we must send in a first strike.
We don't go in for sneak attacks. We had that done.
Matho is also primarily a theater actor and appearing in live television. He had done a series very early in television, one of the first film series, and thank goodness it was a failure because it turned him back. It gave him back to us. Otherwise, he would have been gone forever.
This time, we can finish what we start. And if we act now, right now, our casualties will be minimal.
You know what you're saying. Do you believe that communism is not our mortal enemy?
You're justifying murder.
Yes. To keep from being murdered.
In the name of what? To preserve what? Even if we do survive, what are we? Better than what we say they are? What gives us the right to live, then? What makes us worth surviving, Grotescheller, that we are ruthless enough to strike first?
Yes! Those who can survive are the only ones worth surviving.
Fighting for your life isn't the same as murder.
Where do you draw the line once you know what the enemy is? How long would the Nazis have kept it up, General?
I don't know whether it was ever intended that Gottscheller was Jewish. Hermann Kahn was. And the only hint of it we get is that quick moment in the argument we just heard. I don't think that the book took it any further than that, and we didn't. We didn't want to use it as a diversion from the central argument, and it would have been. It would have been.
Contact our ambassador to Moscow, also the Soviet delegate to the United Nations. Hook them onto my line. When the Soviet premier comes back on the phone, put us all in together.
Yes, Mr. President.
Is the touch phone open between Omaha and the Soviet command headquarters?
Yes, sir. All ready.
Keep it open.
As you can see, a lot of the framing of the move, of the shots, always involves their communications. So that Fonda's not in the center of the frame; he's on the left side of the frame as you're looking at it. So that the phone is as prominent as he is.
His name used to use it in chapel.
From a story point of view, that's what's going on all the time.
I remember, sir.
Keep it in mind the next few hours. Blackie, I need your help. Get out to Andrews Field right away. Orders will be waiting for you there.
Yes, sir.
Blackie, are Catherine and the kids in New York?
Yes, sir.
The heart of all acting is listening. It doesn't matter whether it's film or theater, television. In fact, the fundamental thing of talking to each other and listening to each other is the heart of acting. So here's an exercise where there is no choice because nobody is in the same room together. Speaking to the people whose decisions are going to matter here, they're all separated. All you can do is respond to the moment honestly, using yourself as fully as you can. You can't relegate it to what you want to do with your eyes or what you want to do with any individual thing, because it would become so self-conscious then that you'd find yourself in a straitjacket in no time.
Marshal Nevsky sends his greetings.
The same to him.
Our reception is 5x5. How do you read us?
We read you 5x5.
One moment, please. Mr. President, we're through to them.
Thank you, General. Will you put me on your public address system so everyone can hear what I say? I want the Russians to be able to hear as well.
Yes, sir. Ready, sir.
Gentlemen, this is the President of the United States. Whatever orders I give to American personnel are to be considered direct orders from the Commander-in-Chief.
Only Fonda can say a line like that and you absolutely believe it. This is the President of the United States. Of course it is. Who else could it be?
We must do everything we can to prevent our planes from attacking Moscow. The Soviet Premier has behaved as I believe I would under similar conditions. He has delayed retaliation. I think he believes this.
It's hard to compare the movies because to compare Strange Love and Failsafe because the intentions were so different. Stanley wanted to do it with very, very broad comedy. I mean, the Gottschalk character there, played by Peter Sellers, who couldn't keep his Nazi arm down. You know, done for farcical reasons. The body fluids scene. What is the name of the actor who goes riding down on the bomb? Slim Pickens. The situation was that he created was genuinely not just comedic, it was farcical. And he more than brought it off. It's a brilliant movie. I wish in the release of the pictures that we had been released first, because it would be very hard to take this movie seriously right after you've seen Strange Love. It would be conversely have made Strange Love perhaps work even better than it did if you'd seen this first, because you'd have the source of what was to be laughed at.
Cassio will answer your question.
That's a question, Colonel. That is a direct order. Order, Colonel.
I know that being released second was totally detrimental to the possible success of the movie. It was certainly detrimental. It was certainly detrimental critically and then commercially. Here's the scene with Dom DeLuise. I want to take a look at it because I think he's terrific in this.
Yes, sir. Loud and clear, they've got to know we're on the level. It has both capacities, sir.
Can the radar seeking mechanism be overloaded by increasing the strength of the signal?
Tell them!
Yes, sir. It can be overloaded. By increasing the power output and sliding through radar frequencies as fast as possible, what happens is the firing mechanism reads the higher amperage as proximity to the target and detonates the warhead.
That's a first-rate piece of work.
Thank you, General Bogan. We will be back to you.
That's all, Sergeant. We've told them how to blow up our air-to-air missiles, and with them, our planes.
I'm covering us up.
Thomas, send out the code for the ultimate flight plan. We're going down to the floor.
I don't know where I got this piece of footage. It looks like a Russian plane to me. I don't know if we ever got any footage of an American plane. I think I might have gotten it from some foreign house. It doesn't look like an American plane that I know of.
I'm sorry, General. I don't know what happened. I just couldn't do it. It was like a fit or something.
Turn the light.
Who could have expected this situation? General, General, I think this is all a trap. They wanted this to happen. We know they've been trying to foul up our failsafe signal. I think that we should tell the president it's a trap. They're just using the time to get their missiles ready and fly their bombers into position.
We have no evidence of that.
They could be flying their bombers in the grass. They could have fired missiles already and put them up in the orbit of known satellites where we couldn't detect them. Remember, we computed that problem. We decided satellites could be used to mask missiles.
We computed a lot of problems. I've not been reporting anything I don't know for sure.
I think we should recommend a full-strength attack.
That is not our decision. The Pentagon...
They don't know what we know. They're not soldiers anymore. They're politicians.
One of the problems in the movie was that there was no way on this budget of doing the sound that we would have wanted to do. If ever a picture needed stereo, it would have been this one, with the addresses over public address systems.
Order a first strike, General.
It would not have been... It would not have been a technical trick. It would have just fit organically into what we were doing. We just didn't have the money for it because it's a lot more expensive. You're doubling your tracks and everything as soon as you go into stereo.
The signals we're getting now are too distorted. Will you please give us the position of the three planes? We can fly fighters at various altitudes.
Can do.
Gentlemen, I am taking over command of this post at the specific order of the President of the United States.
He has long been aware that General Bogan is mentally unbalanced and has warned me to observe him closely. The negotiations which General Bogan has been conducting with the enemy are the acts of...
But as part of the reality of the movie, the last thing I wanted was a score. There was no point in... I mean, if you had music under this, it would have totally destroyed whatever reality, whatever belief you had built up.
You're worse than anybody. You wear the uniform. You have men under your command.
I've done other movies without a score. Serpico had very little score. Dog Day had no score at all. And Long Day's Journey had like 7 minutes of music in a 3.5-hour movie. If you can't find a function for the music, if you can't find a reason for the music to do something that the rest of the movie is not doing, you can't have... otherwise, it's just what we call Mickey Mousing, musically stressing what's already there. And that's a very dull kind of score. That just makes noise.
I am now prepared to give you the longitude and latitude of our bombers in accordance with your request.
It depends, but it should be a function that is not being performed by anything else. For example, in the verdict, we use the music in a way almost of explaining Paul Newman's character's background. It was, the idea behind it was something that had to do when he was an acolyte, something that when he was a child, who member of the church, a religious background for him. And this was never articulated in the movie. We never dealt with that. So,
the Soviet premier is coming back on the line, sir.
Therefore, it was performing a function that the script didn't, that we didn't do anything about that in performance. It had its own contribution to make.
On the top floor of the embassy in Moscow, Mr. President.
Where are you, Mr. Lentov?
In the UN building in New York.
I suppose there is a reason for your ambassador and Comrade Lentov to join us.
There is, Mr. Chairman.
Then let's get on with it. His voice is firmer, sir. Final. Like he's made up his mind.
Again, flipping over to the camera is now shooting against the other two walls. That had a double purpose. First of all, to give you a little relief from the steady... the steady quality of just two gray slabs behind him. But also to get us away from the other angles, because I was going to need them later on.
There is always a chance. But I am asking you, what if they cannot? What will you do? Have you made a decision?
Yes. It's my decision, and I take full responsibility. Mr. Swenson, are you on the line?
Yes, Mr. President.
General Bogan?
Yes, sir.
This is what will happen if even one of the bombers gets through. It will drop 2 20-megaton bombs on Moscow. Jay?
Yes, Mr. President.
You might hear the sound of the engines just before the bombs drop. Maybe not. In any case, you'll hear the defensive missiles going off. Right after that, the bombs will explode. I'm told that...
An interesting thing, too, about the movie is that, in a way, it's a real throwback in the genre, in the sense that it's a sci-fi movie, really. But the simplicity of the backgrounds, even in the big war room, which came about really through budget constraints, actually give it a kind of starkness that I remember from a lot of movies in the 20s and 30s. I didn't realize it until I was just looking at it now.
No, no, no. Let you mean me. Listen. I've ordered a Vindicator bomber into the air from Washington. In a few minutes, it will be flying over New York City. It is carrying 2 20-megaton bombs. The moment I know that Moscow has been hit, I will order that plane to drop its bombs. It will use the Empire State Building for ground zero.
You know, one of the things that you hope for when you're working with any actor is what you really want is to be surprised. You've agreed on what the scene is about. You've rehearsed this way of doing it, that way of doing it, so on and so forth. And there's nothing more exciting than when you get to a take that a surprise happens. Obviously, that's one of the critical moments for that character and for the movie.
I don't know any other way, Mr.
And I remember saying to Hank in rehearsal, Hank, there's no way he can even look at anybody else. The decision has to be made so internally. It has to be made, the knowledge of how catastrophic it is. And what he is doing is so intense. No. Somehow or other, you've got to make it your own and relieve anyone else of any responsibility. And when we got to the take, he covered his eyes, and on the camera side, he could have had the phone in the other hand. It could have been perfectly natural in the right hand. But he had the phone in the left hand so that he could cover his face with the eyes with the right hand, and how effective it makes that look right there. I don't know if you've noticed, but all of these shots of the planes flying and so on, they're never the same plane. I don't know where we got this footage, but it is not accurate. And as you see, the cuts last for maybe 2 seconds, 3 seconds, maybe 5.5, 6 feet of cut.
How many of your decoys do you have left?
How many do you need?
Well, I got the bombs. You don't. I want you to take some of those fighters off my tail.
Will do.
Billy?
Yeah?
I depend on you.
General Bogan, can you explain this maneuver? One of your planes has just appeared again.
That's standard procedure, Marshal Nevsky. That's our number 6 plane, the decoy plane. It's just trying to draw your fighters away from our other plane, carrying the bombs.
I see.
It carries only defensive equipment. You don't have to worry about it.
Thank you. We shall try for a cure in any case.
You'll scatter your forces, Marshal. You don't have time for that. I tell you, it doesn't carry any bombs. You don't have to worry about it. You're letting our other plane get through.
Marshal Nevsky has collapsed. It appears, well, I don't know. General Konev is now in command.
Logan, what's happened?
Marshal Nevsky sent his fighters after a plane that carried no bombs. That means our number one plane will almost certainly get through. The Marshal realized that it was too much for him.
General Bogan, this is General Konev. Do you have the remaining plane on your screen?
No, sir, we do not.
We cannot see it on radar, and it is flying so fast, our anti-aircraft is useless. I must assume the plane will get through.
Yes.
I intend to focus all our remaining rockets on the estimated path of the plane and fire them all off at once. Our hope is to set up a thermonuclear barrier that nothing can penetrate.
That might work. It's worth a chance.
Here comes a scene that I had, that I liked an awful lot. Interesting. This, I think, was Walters completely. I don't think it was in the book. Maybe I'm wrong, but I remember particularly the discussions about walking in London. That was a very particular favorite way of spending time for Walter Bernstein, I'm talking about, who wrote the screenplay. The whole idea of playing a scene between two people, except one of them is a still picture, and yet realistically there is a source of conversation between them. He can hear the audio of the other person. And I always found it a very imaginative thing. You got a very good picture of not only the Frank Overton character, but of the man he was talking to. And I think it was part of the attempt to humanize the Russians, because everything and everybody had been so demonized by then, it would have made any conversation impossible.
Shows a large number of ground-to-air rockets ignited ahead of us. They should show on the scope any time now.
Eddie Binns was probably the happiest actor in the world that he finally got to take his mask off. Because he's now flying at a low enough altitude.
Unless we're too low, they'd blow themselves up. What are they doing with him?
General Bogan?
Yes.
They found Mrs. Grady. She's standing by.
Mr. President, we have Grady's wife.
Can we get through to him?
If he follows procedure, he'll contact us when he gets within range of the target. Those are his orders so that we know how to evaluate the strike.
Well, he's been following orders so far.
Yes, sir.
Keep your fingers crossed.
Thomas.
Yes, sir.
Would their rockets follow missiles, too?
I don't see why not. A missile produces heat.
So I think I know what they're going to do. Explode the rockets on top of us, hope to knock us down with a blast. They can do it, too. But how many air-to-air missiles do we have left?
Two.
Okay. Now, the minute you see those rockets ignite on the scope, you fire our missiles and guide them from maximum elevation straight up.
Straight up?
Yeah, maybe our rockets will follow the missiles, explode too high to hurt us.
Yes, sir.
Carol Grady, we're in range. We have to report in.
Watch that script.
I don't remember any deviations from script. I don't usually have that. I don't. It seems, you know, the set is a very pressured place while you're shooting. There is a lot to think about. A lot to. A lot of the problems are constant, and it's a bad place to make decisions. And I find that that's one of the reasons I like rehearsals, because you can work on the problems far more quietly, sensibly, with no pressure of whether of 125 people sitting around and spending the picture's money. So I very often distrust last-minute ideas that take place on the set. However, there have been any number of instances where valuable things have happened. But most of the time, I stay with what we came out of rehearsal with. You can see here in this sequence the acceleration and the editing tempo.
40, we'd better get out of here.
60, 170,000.
Jack, do you... Answer me, please!
You can't trust it, sir. We gotta get out of here.
Janet Ward is playing his wife, and I always loved her work. I remember in television she did a... By the way, that was a completely different plane than the plane you saw before that looked like a Russian plane. Now, there's our Russian plane again, and has nothing to do with the plane that you saw going low across the ground. Janet had done a wonderful job for me in Salem Witch Trials for You Are There. I remember that very specifically. I directed You Are There for its first 2 years when it was a live show. And one of the shows that we did was the Salem Witch Trials, and Janet was in it. And I've always loved her work. And she was... One of the most difficult things in the world for an actor to do is to come in and just do a very tough emotional scene. You're just in for that one day. Everybody's been working for weeks. You feel strained. You feel unconnected to anything. And you do it, and you're finished. That it's over. You really don't feel a part of the picture at all.
General Stark, are there any papers or documents in New York which are absolutely essential to the running of the United States? General Stark?
No, sir. There are important documents, but none of them absolutely essential.
Be any warning given? A lot of lives could be saved if people had a few minutes.
On this short notice, an alert to a big city would do more harm than good. All you'd produce is panic.
What about this?
Maybe he doesn't know his wife is there.
He knows.
The argument that Walter Matthau's character is going to make here, which is the necessity of preserving financial and scientific records, was actively discussed by the Herman Kahns and that whole level of opinion maker at the time. It was the vaults to be made up in the Catskills so that bank records could be brought up there, et cetera, et cetera. In fact, I think they may even exist today.
The joint one of fire control and excavation. Excavation, none of the dead, the effort would be wasted there.
I don't know why people are talking about this movie now, because it really in the past couple of years or so, a lot has come up about it. I can't figure it out. Other than there's also, for instance, been a lot of revival of interest in The Blacklist in that period. And I think what's happened is that now that a certain amount of time has passed, people find it difficult to believe that these kinds of arguments and ideas, the argument of... could actually happen, that somebody would actually argue, oh, of course we can drop a bomb and be bombed and still survive it, and we can save bank records and things like that. That the insanity of that kind of reasoning, as we examine that period, and just as the insanity of the blacklisting time. When I tell my kids about Senator McCarthy and that blacklisting period, they don't know what to make of it. They say, well, how could it happen? I mean, how did you all let it happen? It makes no sense to them. So maybe that's part of it. I don't know.
How did you ever get to be a translator, Buck?
One of the things that you almost always had in pictures like this, and good pictures of this kind, was the calm scene, the getting acquainted scene, just before all hell breaks loose. And we've reached that point in the movie now. You don't see it coming only because the two actors are so terrific.
Very interesting job. I mean, sometimes.
Well, you did a good job today, Buck.
Thanks, sir. All I did was repeat what he said.
He didn't freeze up.
Hagman wasn't intimidated at all with Fonda. You know, his mother was Mary Martin, and one of the greatest stars that the theater had ever had. So from his infancy, he'd been around name people. None of it fazed him or meant much to him, other than just he loved acting with him.
The premier, sir.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Here come the two dollies I was telling you about before. And almost everything that's been shot in here are setups for these two shots.
Only that part of our defense that has a chance of shooting down your bomber is still active. We do not think we have...
We start profile to profile, and you'll see what happens in the two dollies as the scene progresses.
And yet... this was nobody's fault.
I don't agree.
No human being did wrong.
It's the critical scene in the picture in terms of the thematic line of the picture, which will actually be baldly stated by Fonda. We both let our machines get out of hand.
It was an accident.
Two great cities may be destroyed. Millions of innocent people killed. What do we say to them, Mr. Chairman? Accidents will happen.
Again, duplicate patterns, starting on the loudspeaker pan to the left, starting on the loudspeaker pan to the right. That kind of balance, I think, has a value for a picture like this.
All I know is that men are responsible. We're responsible for what happens to us. Today we had a taste of the future. Do we learn from it or do we go on the way we have? What do we do?
By the way, Shirley, technically...
What do we say to the dead?
The camera has actually dollied 270 degrees, even though the actor has been revealed only over a 90-degree axis, because we were dollying around the outside. With that, that tightness, and on that particular lens, because they're longer lenses, it's an exceedingly difficult shot to do. Difficult for the camera operator and very difficult for the dolly man, the grip who's on the dolly. When I talk about the Beast, I'm referring to the camera, but it's with complete affection. Only because in those days it was so bloody heavy. I refer to it as a Beast in total affection. It's not anti. It's because it's the 8,000-pound gorilla. It sits wherever it wants to.
Put me through to General Black.
Yes, Mr. President.
Blackie.
Yes, Mr. President.
Moscow's been destroyed. Drop your bombs according to plan.
Yes, sir. We've all been briefed on the mission, so there's nothing more to say. I have only one last order. Nobody else has to have anything to do with the dropping of the bombs. Indeed, I will fly the plane and release the bombs. The final act is mine.
On course, sir. Approaching target.
Countdown from 10. Give me the signal.
I felt at the end that we couldn't go out on a mushroom cloud. It had been seen, so all I wanted was the most... All I wanted was the most simple human factor present, which we'll see in a second in the frozen frames that follow it. And here, of course, is his opening nightmare of the killing of the bull and the matador, and he realizes that it's been him. so that the shots that we just saw... are the simplest human elements, and that's what's been cut out. And that's the end of the movie. And there's the shouts of the ole, his nightmare sound that came true for him. Charlie McGuire was the first assistant director I ever had. Storyboard Incorporated was the name of Faith Hubley and John Hubley's company. Annahel Johnston, I did, I don't know, 10, 12, 14 pictures with. Jack Fitzstevens, the sound editor, we did at least that many pictures together. Howard Fortune, Eddie Knott. One of the joys of movie making is gathering a crew around you that you feel close to and can work with over and over again. And I don't know how many pictures that crew and I did together, maybe 15. And here comes the disclaimer, which Columbia felt they had to put on in order, I don't know whether it was to protect themselves legally. Nothing could have happened legally. To me, it's hilarious and, of course, totally destructive to the movie. We've just spent an hour and a half trying to convince you that this could happen. And they put a disclaimer on which says it cannot happen. But I tell you what, I'll bet you we told the truth and they didn't.